never knew how to tell you.
I would
tell
be able to talk about my
Can
life.
You what
have I ever loved a lot?
Yeah, I have two moms.
You want me to say it out loud?
When you're young, it's easy to believe people who label you weird or abnormal because your sexuality is different than theirs.
That's cute. Okay, let's try
it
again.
Should I put it on auto?
No, keep it on manual. And
As a teenager, nobody ever called me a queer or a homo. I had a boyfriend and a heterosexual identity. When I came out as a lesbian in my 20s, I discovered how complicated life can be.
Do people choose to be gay, you think?
I don't think so. I mean, everybody say, well, that's how they choose to be. But I don't think it's a choice. I mean, I never chose it.
There's anger, frustrations within you. They tell you, you know, you can't be this way because your mom says it's sin, and the Bible says that.
Fear and prejudice run deep.
My mom is really skeptical about my homosexuality.
Not every gay and lesbian young person can afford to be as open as the young people who worked with me. Being public is risky. In fact, given the rates of suicide and homelessness among gay and lesbian youth, these teens are the rare exceptions. Homosexuality still carries a big stigma. Consequently, a lot of young people experience homophobia in both obvious and subtle ways.
The whole scene about actually the gays and things, you know, to each his own, but she doesn't really approve of it so much. And she respects it because of her sister.
I respect everybody's opinion.
She expects everybody's opinion, but she doesn't have to tolerate it so much.
In addition to the video I shot, I also asked my collaborators to create their own self-portraits using a camcorder. These segments are conceived and edited by the teenagers themselves.
So anyway.
So, okay, my self-portrait, right?
Yeah.
I basically wanted to do about love, friendship, and sex.
Women loving women, friends, lovers, sex, relationships. There is my ex-lover, Santoy, who broke my heart.
Ah! It's like, no. Ex-lovers, too many of them.
She told me that we needed to break up because she's very confused and she needs to be alone. And at first I was very, very hurt, very sad, because I'm so in love with her. Can anyone explain love?
Well, I think it's a pretty fleeting state of mind, you know, like, to me, it's like two people come together and it peaks and it maintains or it doesn't, but it always, that's been my experience, you know, but it's just like a spiral.
And if we don't, get back together. I know we will be friends.
I went up to the coach check yesterday, guys, and I looked at Monique and I said, I am so happy that I have you as a friend. I think you're a beautiful person. And I'm glad we're working on this tape together. And I just really find great joy and nourishment from our relationship.
Whoa!
Here's my current lover, Nicky.
My relationship to my niece is different than my relationship to Monique. Basic hopes that both were developed will be the same.
If you don't know me by now,
you will never know
me.
Ooh.
All the things.
All right, Diana. Snatch the microphone.
The lesbian community offers a safe environment. You can be comfortable with your sexuality without having to worry about other people's perceptions.
When I first came out, I was actually very feminine. I had long hair and wore big earrings and wore pink all the time. And I don't know, I ended up in a hall with this butch. And she was coming on to me, and I was like, no, I'm sorry. She said, what's the matter? You don't like women like me? And I said, no, I don't. And she said, well, honey, you better change your clothes and change your hair if you want to get any other woman. So I did.
What are you doing?
I'm dressing up as a typical butch. I would rather wear boots, but can't find them right now, so. Am I looking butcher by the minute? Huh?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay. Yeah. Yeah. And if a butch were to wear glasses, they'd probably wear these. I used to wear these when I was a butch. Round glasses, of course. Those are the glasses that lesbians wear.
What happened, Ma? What grade was I in these pictures?
You still had your baby teeth. I think that was from kindergarten.
Okay, I called up everyone in my immediate family, and I told them I wanted to meet with them. And they all came up with that I was pregnant, which is pretty hysterical, when I came out and said I was a lesbian. Well, actually, I don't think I said I was a lesbian. I said I was gay. I think at that point I wasn't comfortable saying lesbian yet.
There's me when I was a baby.
You look like a little angel.
There's a picture of me with the Bo Derek look.
The yelling and the tears and my mother crying and my aunt telling her that it was all her fault because she didn't give me the right upbringing. And I mean, my cousin who was in college was like, wow, you know, can't you at least be bisexual? My grandmother was like, you know, what's wrong, Mom? You want to be a boy? No, Grandma, I don't want to be a boy. I know what I am. I just love other women.
No,
and
the when you just
she just
up.
Looked at me like I was a total freak. This picture was right before I totally came out. This picture. Mm-hmm. This past year, last year, I moved 4 times. It's really annoying. When I moved at 15, when I left home, I just had a suitcase already packed up because I had a feeling that I'd have to be leaving suddenly very soon.
I had a friend of mine over who was straight, who I just came out to, and she was in my room and we had the door closed, and they totally freaked out. They thought that I was doing something with her in my room. So they like, you know, banging on the door, open the door, and they like started yelling at me and yelling at her and telling her to get out of the house, and I was really embarrassed. You know, this was just a straight friend of mine who I had just come out to, so she was already a little bit freaked out, and then she was even more freaked out because then they were accusing her of messing around with me, and then me and my aunt got into a little bit of a physical fight, and so then I just, my cousin came walking in, and I grabbed my suitcase, and she drove me off. She just drove me away, and that was it. I guess I just didn't get to have as much fun as, you know, most like 15-year-olds would have because I had to work. But I was happy anyway because I was able to be who I was, and that's what was most important to me.
The high school I went to was a Catholic all-girl high school. Uniforms, nuns. I dropped out of school because I knew I would be harassed, and I just couldn't deal. I couldn't deal with it. I could not deal with it, and I didn't want to deal with it. I wanted to just be me and go do what I needed to do, and I did. Well, I'm the coat check at the Click Club. It's been hard because I have contact with 80 to 90% of the women that come to the Click Club, especially on Friday nights.
Yeah, but it's kind of expensive.
So there's an opportunity right there to strike up a conversation if they find me attractive and to tip me very well, and then, you know what I mean? My friends, when I was like 17, 18, they used to, you know, call me Don Juan and all these other names. I was ecstatic about being a lesbian, and everyone else was freaking out and being really negative. Just loving another woman was just so incredible. It was such an incredible feeling. It was so real. It was so right. I never, ever, ever felt anything like that when I was, you know, going out with boys. I don't know. It's really strange because I can't believe that I dropped out of high school, and that I didn't even get my GED, and that I haven't been to college, because I just feel like my mentality is beyond that.
This is where I'm going to be living now for the next 2 months. It's in the East Village, and there's Frances. She's a... Frances, you're a little bit more enthusiastic. Anyway, that's Frances, and that's Iris, my ex-girlfriend and friend. And there's Stacy back there, typing.
There's a lot of important things in my life right now, Joan. Well, independence. Freedom, you know,
I need to spend a lot of time by myself. I need to stop messing around with all these women. And, you know, I just need to get things straight in my life. I need to go to school. I need to just do a lot of things for me.
I live on the Upper East Side of Manhattan with my mom, while my father, brother, and sister reside in Los Angeles. This is where I went to high school. It's a private prep school. Although I came out to my family and best friend, no one there knew I was gay. I had to repress who I really was.
What do you think about repression?
In what terms?
Well, what do you think of when you think of the word repression?
Well, I think that sometimes people, instead of facing reality, they put their feelings on the back burner. They don't want to face them. What do you think about repression?
What do I think about? My ex-boyfriends.
This is my best friend in the whole world, Michael Doyle. I'm filming you. Was there ever a time in your life when you had to repress yourself?
Before I came out, I had to repress myself, and I remember what that felt like.
Nobody has given anybody been more fair to you, given more to you than me, and you haven't been thankful for it.
Well, give me a break.
No, you haven't.
Even though my mom and I have our differences, we actually get along very well. In all of our arguments, she never once threw the fact that I'm gay in my face.
Everybody else does.
Wait, hold still for a second.
Instead of trying to help me, you're not. You're doing things to help yourself, but not me.
Oh, give me a break.
Yeah, let me give me a break. The garbage is filled to capacity here.
So I'm going to be taking it out in a second.
I can't believe these
azaleas
bloomed over here.
They did?
It's
why?
It's very strange.
I knew
it. Vacation, all I ever wanted. Vacation, had to get away. Vacation.
I think people who are repressed have all these strong thoughts and feelings inside of them.
Vacation,
these repressed things are probably very basic to who they are. And they probably hurt a lot. They're probably pretty sad because of it.
People who repress themselves are always trying to hide something. The more you repress yourself, the more anger and frustration you build up inside yourself. Unfortunately, but people still do it.
Peter's mom just wanted mothers and fathers out there to know that they shouldn't be ashamed if they have a son or a daughter who is gay.
I came out to my family when I was 15, and at 19 I decided that I wanted a little more out of my life with someone else. So I put an ad in the pen pal section of a newspaper in Canada. First, I met some people who basically only wanted sex and sent me naked pictures. And I didn't want that. I wanted something more fulfilling. So then I met this guy named Richard. These are things that Richard has given to me over time, and this was the first thing that I got from him. It was his class ring, and it meant a lot to me. And he sent it by Federal Express. And called me up the night before and told me that it was going to arrive. These are all letters that he sent me before I met him. And then we spoke on the phone, which cost him like $40 for the first time. And I got this, his football jersey, since he played football in high school. He sent it to me because I wanted it. Okay. Here's a picture of us. I like this picture, it's my favorite. That's a nice picture. For the first time in my life, I fell in love with somebody. And it's kind of scary because he did too. People have been telling me, well, you can't fall in love with somebody. He's in Canada and it's impossible. And yeah, I think it's great.
Soup. Zucchini curry soup.
Could you give me the recipe for this so I can give it to my mom? I think it's really good.
Well, I have a wonderful son whose name is Peter, who happens to be gay, and whom I love very much.
Oh, well, yeah. I don't know, because I feel awkward, right? At least you're comfortable, like, with yourself, right? So that's okay, but...
You're not?
Well, no, I wasn't. Well, when I first came here, it was a little...
I hope Peter will not be disappointed. I understand that Richard has not acknowledged his homosexuality to his parents, and has never had a homosexual experience.
Well, my friends, I hope that they will know, but anyone else, if they don't ask or they don't question, then that's, if I don't seem gay to them, well, that's fine by me.
Peter just may be a guinea pig.
When Richard goes back, we'll continue our relationship, but it'll just have to be through visits. We were talking about this the other day, and we planned out the next 8 years of our lives.
Don't do that.
Why?
Because... Well, the same things prevail. I mean, it's just everyday life, whether, you know, being homosexual or heterosexual. I don't see a big difference in those two things. I mean, they both have houses, they both have, you know, cars. So, for myself, I think it'll be just the same thing, except, you know, it's not going to be man and wife kind of idea.
Well, that sounds almost as bad as Mr. Doyle.
Yeah, I'm going to confront it when I come back. Now I feel much better with myself having come here.
It doesn't really matter to me what a person is. They don't have to be black or white or straight or gay.
It's kind of like taking a weight off your chest, that kind of thing. Just being able to freely express yourself without worrying about catching yourself saying something.
I know I only lived with him for 12 days, but it felt like such a long time. I just got a letter from him yesterday. I'm gonna be going up to Canada where Richard lives in a few weeks. And he said that he asked his mother and she's, you know, fine about the situation. I mean, but she just thinks I'm his friend. So, I mean, I'm gonna be sleeping in the same bed as him. So it's not like I'm gonna be staying on the couch. I think I'm gonna feel really uncomfortable, like around his friends especially, because they're these stereotypical jock type people. You know, they're not very supportive to the gay lifestyle. Richard says to me that you have to act a certain way because, you know, you can't, like, get very affectionate around me. I was like, well, I'm not planning to. I'm not stupid. I know that, you know, I'm not going to give him away and, like, say, oh, well, Richard's gay. I pretend I'm his friend, and I'm his friend, and that's it, no more, no less. Well, when I got back from Canada, Richard told his mother that he's gay, and she had a hard time dealing with that. So I thought if I wrote her a letter, it would help her understand better. So this is what she wrote me back. Dear Peter, I hope you are well. I have a difficult time to accept you as a lover to Dick. By the way, his name is Dick, not Richard. I like you. You did make a good impression with me. Thank you for the recipes. I will use them in my restaurant, Anne-Marie. Which kind of made me feel a lot better, knowing that she wrote me back and it was kind of positive. I felt bad that I never met his friends. I don't know, I guess I'm still really afraid of how people are going to react to me being gay. I guess I always will, until gay people are always accepted, no matter who you tell about your sexuality.
Soon after this interview, I received a message from Peter on my answering machine.
Joan, hi, it's Peter. I just got a pretty pathetic letter from Richard. It just says that he never loved me. He wanted to believe that he did, and what he did was wrong.
I don't know. Regardless of what happens with Richard, I want to continue with the videotape. I don't know how we can figure out the ending. I think it's kind of like, I don't know, I think of it like a soap opera when a character dies, you know. Give me a call back tonight, we can talk about this more. Bye-bye.
11:12 p.m.
This young man wanted to remain anonymous. He was 15 when I began interviewing him.
Told you that he or she is gay. Today is National Coming Out Day, the day when
in high school especially you really have to try to keep things to yourself. People find out they go crazy. The sexual part in high school is so open because, you know, you can see, you know, a girl on a guy kissing and all that other stuff, activity. And you don't see two girls doing that. I mean, they probably get killed right there. The people in my school, they obviously pick it up and they use it as a weapon. They like the whole fun. Make the crowd laugh.
Oh, no way, no way.
Homo.
Whoa.
Faggot. Doing it at other people's expense. If you're going to high school, you have to take the train. You have to ride almost to your house with these people bothering you. It's rough. Like, I'm talking like after school. And the bad part about it is you gotta go back the next day to be, what, tormented, tortured, you know, and soon you begin to say the hell with it, you know? I don't want to go back to school.
Why aren't you on camera? I knew there was something I had to ask you.
My ignorance, right?
Why, why is your identity anonymous?
Well, because there's mass discrimination out there.
I could be ridiculed, hurt physically, mentally tarnished, all kinds of things. I wish that I could show my face, but it's too much. I wouldn't have peace of mind if I was shown on the video.
What defines masculinity? Does it exclude everything feminine?
All right, I'm not trying to say I'm the most masculine guy in the world, you know, because I'm certainly not. I mean, I myself think I have some feminine qualities.
He would sometimes ask me whether I thought his mannerism seemed to suggest that he was weak or effeminate.
Well, not to you,
but maybe to other people, I seem to fit the stereotype. This book basically is divided into two sections, one dealing with Black America and the other one dealing with gay America, which is like the two biggest things that make up my personality, my race, and like my sexual orientation.
So have you shown it to anyone aside from us?
I showed it to my mother's friend, and I showed it to a lot of other people in my family. And they basically gave me their criticism, their good, their bad, and whatever. But basically, I got them to do what I wanted them to do, which is to think. Uh-oh, you ready, Joan? Here comes your picture.
Uh-oh.
Miss Power Lesbian.
I get the section right next to the male body.
Could you accept your son or your daughter, your cousin, your best friend, saying, I want you to know now that I am gay?
Okay, do you think straight guys are afraid of, or think it's
well,
really...
they're afraid. It's like a domino effect. It's like... he's gay, so I'll turn into one if I hang with him long enough.
Oh.
You know.
You think so?
They think it's going to rub off onto them.
Right.
But see, that's all an insecurity.
Welcome into my kingdom. Come one, come all.
I have told some people at school, but I use my judgment wisely. I haven't told any guys yet, though. That would be my experiment to try to tell another guy that I've told only females in my school. When I'm talking with straight guys, we have generally heterosexual conversation. I use that little small percentage as heterosexual. You have to just talk their language. Gendia, Vivier, is that right? Mars, April, May. No, I'm not having a relationship right now. The main problem is I just can't find, I don't know where these people are. Because that person is hiding from you. He think you're straight and you think he's straight. So it's really hard. It's really hard.
November et December. Tous les mois d'année. I'm rusty. I had French for 6 years and can't speak it.
I got this fantasy that when high school is over, I'm gonna begin to live a life. But I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. The night was warm. The light was dim. There we lie on top of each other, with the world on top of our heads. The bigotry, hatred, fear, and dishonesty takes toll on our daily lives. Our cries scream and moan because we know our world. We know it well. Even with disease on our minds and poverty in our people's background, we live in the daily hope that our devotion will shine. There we lie, black bodies upon one another. In our mind, we are just people, but to the world, we are different. Tears begin to flow. Mine's upon your body, yours upon mine. Feels so cool, like raindrops in an African rainforest, purifying our soul, purifying our minds from the shame, ignorance, and intolerance of the world. We whisper, everything is going to be all right, and it will be, because we hold each other tight. Light comes across our arrested face, a new day of hell, but forever shall we be confronted by the world together.
To whom it may concern, my name is Henry Diaz. This is my cat, Weedy.
Say hi, Weedy. He's too tired to say hi. You're in my room right now. These are my clothes. My Cure jacket over there. Whoops, sorry about that. That must have been uncomfortable, huh? Some of my, more of my clothes there. This is my art table. I do my sketches and my drawings. My color pencils there, my comic books off to the side there, in the back. Markers, cigarettes. I smoke, but only once in a while. There's my Boy Scout uniform. I used to be a Boy Scout. Never made it to Eagle, but I had fun though.
Yo. In my language, maricón, pato, pájaro means faggot, you know what I'm saying? Gay people, or even guys who like to dress like women, or want to be females. All I know is that if one of them looks my way, or even tries to touch me, there's going to be mad beef.
On my block, butchers look at you even if you're not a lesbian. They will still scope your ass. And sometimes they'll even try to come on to you. You know, these homos need a good whack in the head just to straighten them out.
Oh, there's a picture of there of me and my brother. Would you like to see that? Come on, let's check it out. Oh, there's me and my brother.
I want to know why anyone would want to be this way.
Yo, check out this joke. It's mad old, but it still be bugging me out. What do you call a fag on roller skates? Give up, roll-aids.
I just want to show you that I'm just like anybody else. I have my pride, I have my friends, my goals, my dreams, my pleasures, my desires, my hopes for the future, if there is any future later on, where we're going. But there's one thing that's important to me, and that's being myself.
Sometimes, there's a distinction between who you are in public and who you can be in private.
I'm 17. I'm gay. There's a relief to come out.
Henry was like, I mean, big, like, gay teen star. I mean, celebrity, totally.
Tonight, the focus of Catherine's Kids is gay and lesbian youth leadership. This is a bit personal, but I'll start and end with personal. You knew you were gay. At what age?
I confirmed it at 9. I knew that I was attracted to men at 6.
I came out to my high school near the end of my sophomore year. Things were really going good for me, and the next thing I wanted to accomplish was that I wanted to move out of my parents' house. I wanted to date guys without having any problems. By leaving my house, I would keep myself sane.
Henry's home life is like not hell, but it's like, my God, there's so many pressures on him because he has like the Brady Bunch family, and like they're all living in like a really tiny apartment.
I made up this phony college letter saying that I got accepted to such and such college. My parents believed it. They thought I was going to go to school down in Florida, to Tampa, to study marine biology. They figured I must be super smart and doing really good, and they have a really bright kid on their hands, and da-da-da-da. I'll be on the phone with my mom. Oh, wow, it's really hot over here. How's it up there? In reality, I was in the Bronx. I was in the Bronx, the South Bronx. My school used to send out like these absent cards. So my mother came up to the school to tell the school that I wasn't living anymore at their house, that I was living in Florida. they told her, well, ma'am, you're wrong. Your son is here. He is not in Florida. And so they sent the dean to get me downstairs in my drama class. The dean was like, well, are you Henry Diaz? And I was like, yeah, I'm Henry Diaz. And he said, your parents are upstairs waiting for you. I'm half Dominican and half Sicilian. My mother's side of the family, they're strong and determined. And since my mother is that way, she's taught me a lot to withstand all the odds.
I got two. Oops. Love that aim.
See, tomorrow we're going to a conference where we're going to do a training, a youth empowerment training, one of the trainings that they're like, we provide, and we need packets to distribute to people so they can know what Youth Force is and what we can provide for them.
Youth Force is a leadership training program.
The AIDS pamphlet.
I learned community organizing skills, and I was even doing AIDS education and stuff like that.
This workshop is about how young people can be a part of the solution. So we want your recommendations to be around youth action and not around governmental action or school action.
What helped me come out was working at Youth Force. The people there are really cool, and they're the ones who really helped me believe in myself.
I think to stick with the original idea is much
better. I met this guy, Alan, through Youth Force, who was totally out with me. And I thought that was cool, that you could be open with someone that you just met. He was a gay activist, and I began to really express my gay identity after that.
Next is Henry Diaz.
Right now, it's really hard for me to speak about this because this is the first time I spoke to a crowd about my homosexuality. I've been interviewed for several articles, like People Magazine. I don't know if anyone has read People Magazine over the month. I came out in an issue there on teens and sex. My feelings and who I am was just written on ink. Now I'm just verbalizing it to people. And it's really hard for me, so try to cope with me. Thank you. Thank you. That feels better now.
A neighbor of mine from where I used to live at saw the People Magazine article. And when she saw my mom, she told my mom, look, Maria. My mom totally freaked out.
Do you know that you were in such and such magazine and they said that you were gay and that you were there with, they had a picture of you and this other guy and this homosexual, this bato, a faggot.
Do you know you came out of this magazine where they said you were gay and that you were going to these clubs, blah, 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 and I was like, yeah. And she said, since when you know, did you know that these people, like, you know, wrote these lies about you? And I said, no, Ma, you know, these aren't lies, it's the truth, you know. My father was the one who surprised me. After arguing with him about it, saying, no, 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 this is the way I feel, he accepted it. But my mom was the one who cried and cursed and got really cold towards me.
My father kept on constantly calling and leaving these messages like, Henry, call me, blah, 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 number. Your mother's going crazy. You have to come back and tell your mom that
that no, you're not gay, that you went to some psychiatrist or something, and he said that you're not gay because your mother's really freaking out and she's taking it out on us and I can't deal with her, I'm gonna leave her, this and that. Then you're gonna have to come over here and take care of her yourself. And I was like, oh God, I have to go over there and, you know, tell a lie. So I went over to my mother's house like 3 days later, and I went over there and told my mom that, Mom, you know, I went over to the psychiatrist and he said, no, I'm not gay. And she was like, well, I told you so. See, I told you you weren't gay. I told you so. You're so crazy. You kids these days get these things in your head. I'm living back at home now. My mom knows. She listens to my telephone conversations. I know she knows. She just won't admit it. It's like my little mural right here on my closet door. I really had no idea like what I'm going to draw. I just start out with shapes and stuff. And then from there, I'll get inspired by the shapes and I'm like, okay, I'll make the circle of sun and then I'll make this stick, you know, a trunk, and then and the bottom will be roots. And I just from there went on and I came up with this, and it really held some truth for me.
My poem. It's called Reliving My Alabama. I's got three things going against me. I is a woman. I is an Afro Caribbean American. I is a lesbian. 16 years of slavery hiding in the closet, keeping me shackled in chains of depression and self-destruction, and brainwashed by the ideologies of Massasoit, Prozac, Thorazine. Encased in and watched over by the world of iron bars and Velcro straps, tearing at my veins, burning at my soul. My brain whipped with pain by the jolts and volts of electricity that tried to make me forget that I was living in Alabama and that I would keep on reliving my Alabama. Didn't they know? Ain't they smart enough? Ain't the degree of their PhD telling me I is crazy, woman, Afro-Caribbean American, lesbian. Had to play sane, had to play the game, but freedom, but still enslaved, cause I can't be free to be me. I can't hold my lover, touch my lover, kiss my own lover. Damn the democracy we call our society. I've got five things going against me. I is a woman. I is an Afro-Caribbean American. I is a lesbian. I is a conformist and as every other damn ism, and I is reliving my Alabama.
Nicky was raised a Jehovah's Witness. The conflict between her Jehovah faith and her sexual feelings has become less confusing for her now.
I used to come here like every day when I first came out. This is the pier, that's what we hear is music. Always, that's the pier. If you want to make it like so legal or legit, I could say when I hit 13, and I knew. I mean, I always knew, but it was 13. And then I started going out with guys still to be like, well, maybe I could change. Maybe I just need that one good piece of beef, as everybody says, or that one good man to really change me. And even you could say when I did get that guy, I still was not, something felt incomplete of the relationship. And I knew what it was, I knew it. But I just couldn't, I didn't want to accept it because I was like, oh my God. And like, will I start looking like a man? And will I start looking like this? And will I do this? How will I react? How will I view life? And it seems like since I came out, I view life so much more positively, even when things are dense, because I know who I am, which to me, a lot of people can't say they know who they are. At least I know my sexuality, which is the biggest thing. You know, that's a big thing.
Nicky explained that because of family problems, she's lived a good deal of her life in and out of foster care.
Well, you're in the Upper East Side, and this is my group home. It's really not considered a group home. Legally and technically, it's considered independent living residence, which they don't give us any independence, but they think they do. I'm out the closet. I had two of my ex-boyfriends live in this house, and for one of them, it took like really a hard time to get used to me. But like now we're good friends, and he accepts it. I didn't even tell Rick that I was gay. He happened to hear it through the grapevine.
Just the way I did not want it to happen. But.
And the reason why I didn't tell him is because I know how men's pride is and how he would view it. And I knew that Rick was really homophobic. Because we would like sit up in the room and he'd talk about, you know, like, faggots this. And I was like, you know, that's not, I couldn't tell him because I knew that he was going to be upset.
I mean, she mentioned something about me being homophobic. I am, in a way, all right? But I'm not homophobic to the point where, you know, I'm prejudiced towards someone because of their, like, sexual orientation. I don't, like, think it's, I don't know, not right, because right and wrong is not, like, always that clear. But it's just something that doesn't agree with me, but that doesn't mean I'd, like, alienate somebody because they're gay, because they're white, Chinese, gay, whatever. You know, everybody has the right to do their own thing. And it's, who am I to say, oh, well.
But there was a difference because I was with you, so that's what made the difference.
Yeah, I mean, that hurts. That's like getting kicked in the nuts with a steel-toed boot. It's like, and you didn't even tell me. But I dealt with it. It took me a while.
Very long time.
I'm still dealing with it.
Yes, he is. I don't know where we're going, but we're going. I know how to get there. And we're gonna go see her, my lover, my baby. Yes, I love her. I saw Maria and I was just like, oh, she's hot. Oh God, it was a lust thing. I was lusting after her when I first saw her. To change because I don't match because I'm a butch. I don't believe you.
Well, see, it's like we go through these things. Like, I'm very girl today, she's very girl today, but I'm not used to seeing her in garb.
They're doing a documentary on me, Sara. Yeah. It's America's most wanted people who have like changed their lives after prison, people who've changed their lives after prison. Some of my Jehovah's Witness doctrines, because that's what I was born with, that's how I think. I kind of like excommunicated myself, but if I was still in the faith and going to the Kingdom Hall and everything, they would disassociate me out of the organization until I changed. It hurts, because most of my friends were all Jehovah's Witnesses. And I could say those were like my true, true friends, but they don't talk to me now because of that. I've kind of, they don't know, but they don't talk to me because I don't go to the Kingdom Hall. That's why they don't talk to me. So you know if I tell them that I'm a homosexual, how they would react to that. And that's the biggest thing. That is a sin, beyond a sin. That's, I'm another Sodom and Gomorrah, you know. When I was younger, being with God, I used to want to kill myself every single day. I couldn't, I was like scared to accept my feelings of who I was.
since Maria, I've come more so out of the closet than before.
Every day.
We see each other every day. We've missed like twice.
We've missed 2 days.
For a month and a week, 2 weeks.
We're going to end it all.
We love each other like so much, and like people won't let us.
Society is so horrible.
Yeah.
They won't let us love each other.
Let's do it, Maria.
Goodbye, cruel world.
Ready?
You got it?
Got it.
Goodbye, cruel world.
Bye. Ah! Not. I've had so many people since I've came out tell me it's just a phase, and they've been trying to brainwash me to be a different way. I'm just a normal teenager who is going through the regular everyday-to-day thing, and I'm in love. It's not a man, so what?